Good evening, everybody. Great to have you with us. Welcome to our evening service. It's a bit of a different evening service this evening, as we haven't been able to do our normal recording for the evening service. Some of us are still in self-isolation at the moment, and so we're putting together a slightly different evening service for you. But we're going to be looking at a talk that I did a while ago that I think is going to really bless us as we watch it again. It's on the first of the series of Revelation Revealed, looking at the book of Revelation and what it all means and how it really holds together. And we're going to have some wonderful worship as well this evening. So I really pray that this evening really blesses you. And just as we start, we're going to pray, then we're going to worship the Lord in song. So Father, thank you so much for this opportunity for us to come together, to meet with you, to look at your word, to be refreshed and encouraged by your word. Thank you that in these uncertain times we can cry out to you, we can sing out to you, we can connect with you in songs of worship. And so I pray that this evening, Lord, would you draw close to us as we seek to draw close to you. And may you truly bless us, and may this be something that really sets us up for this coming week. We love you, we worship you, and we pray, come Holy Spirit, and do what only you can do this evening, in Jesus' name. Amen. So let's worship the Lord together, shall we? Let us lift our voices together in song.
Fear in death, grace is the power of Christ. demands my destiny. No power of hell, no scheme of man can ever pluck me from his hands till he returns or calls me home. Here in the power of Christ I'll stand. No power of hell, no scheme of man can ever pluck me from his hand till he returns or calls me home. Oh, here in the power of Christ I'll stand till he returns or calls me home. Here in the power of Christ I'll stand.
It's not the end of the road, so get up and go. Oh, my soul, you're free to roam, my soul. There's so much more to behold that God wants to show.
are launching out where, I was going to say where angels fear to tread, but I'm sure they don't. But we're launching out on a look at together at the whole of the book of Revelation, not just this evening. It's going to take longer than this evening. And hopefully it's going to be enlightening, helpful, and exciting. And I'm not sure how many weeks it's going to take, because I haven't actually written it all yet, but it's definitely going to take several, and it's definitely going to be great. And we're definitely not all going to agree with everything that I say. But we're going to stay friends. Let me just read to you some just the beginning of the first chapter of the book of Revelation. This is a revelation of Jesus Christ, which God gave him to show his servants the events that must soon take place. He sent an angel to present his revelation to his servant John, who faithfully reported everything he saw. This is his report of the word of God and the testimony of Jesus Christ. God blesses the one who reads the words of this prophecy to the church, that's me, and he blesses all who listen to its message, that's you, and obeys what it says, that's all of us, for the time is near. New year, new start, and the start of a new look at the book of the Bible that has probably caused more controversy than any other. It is the most controversial book within the most controversial book in history. So it shouldn't present too much of a problem for us. It'll be fine. Now, we're looking at this just after celebrating the season of peace and goodwill to all people. And those attributes are good ones to bring into a study of this book. Peace and goodwill to all people, especially the person who's speaking to you. We will not agree on everything. You may have a completely different view to this than I have, and that's okay. It is okay to disagree. After all, none of us has the absolute perfect insight into all things. It's not whether we disagree or not, so much as how we do it. I feel like I could be speaking, if anybody would listen, to the nation here. It's not whether we disagree, it's how we do it. Not with klaxons and bullhorns and all of that, but with grace. We need to do it. We need to talk and, if necessary, to disagree with peace and goodwill. So with that in mind, I want to spend the next number of weeks not going into minute detail about such things as potential references to drone warfare or whether nuclear weapons are mentioned and the like, so much that, or even seeking to uncover when it's all going to happen. What I want to do is to enable us to understand the structure of this book, understand some of the understandings that the book was originally based upon, and that's going to help us to see what this letter is getting at a bit more clearly, or this epistle is getting at a bit more clearly. Hope you like the graphic. Revealed. There are a number of different ways, or overall ways, that people interpret Revelation. In fact, the first four verses of the book of Revelation tell us four things about it. So, chapter 1, verse 1, it tells us this is an apocalyptic book. Apocalypse does not mean big budget Hollywood. It means revelation, that which was hidden that is being revealed. It's an apocalyptic book. It's referring to the type of literature that it is, apocalyptic literature, and it's a revelation. Verse 2, it's a testimony or it's a witness about Jesus Christ. Verse 3, it's a prophecy, which is, as someone once said, light from the future shining on the present. And verse 4, it's a letter, so it's got a pastoral element. Now, there are four major ways of interpreting this whole book of Revelation. View number one, I'm not inviting you to take your pick necessarily, but I'm just saying that there are four major views. View number one, it's all in the past. So it was written solely for the time in which the Apostle John lived. There was suffering, the church was being persecuted, and so John wrote this letter, or had it dictated to him, to encourage the church of his day to hang on, because God will rescue you. But that, of course, would mean that it has no direct meaning for the past 2,000 years. That was interesting then, but it's not much of a revelation for us now. View number two. It's all in the future. So it's all predictive of the last days of the earth. Now, this is a popular view, but again, the problem would be that it would have no meaning for the last 2,000 years. It would have had no meaning when it was being written at that time. You know, that's confusing, Lord, and so what? View number three. It's a symbolic portrayal of timeless truths. So those truths are relevant for whatever age you're in. Now, people who hold to this view, they would generally speaking not believe in the rapture of the church or the tribulation happening for a literal 7 years or the 1,000 years of reign on earth of Christ, i.e. the millennium. And this is generally called the amillennial view, the amillennial view. View number four, it relates to human history, past, present, and future. And that it points us prophetically not to just seven specific churches that John knew about, but also to the seven ages of the church in history. And these seven churches were real churches of John's day, but they were also representative of the church throughout the ages, followed by the rapture and the tribulation and the second coming and the millennial reign of Christ and on into eternity. Now, let me reiterate, different people have different views. My view, which I want to explain over the coming weeks, is the fourth view. And the reason I think that view is one that best fits the text we'll look at together. And you can form your opinion on that. But in essence, it seems to me that the book of Revelation is dealing with three time periods. And those three time periods are summed up in the verse that really you could say is the master key to the book of Revelation. It's the verse that enables us to understand the structure of the whole thing. It's chapter 1, verse 19. And it says this. Jesus is saying to John, write, therefore, what you have seen, what is now, and what will take place later. What you've seen, what is now, what will take place later. Now, as I say, that's Jesus talking to John the Apostle as he was in exile on the island of Patmos in the year around about 95 AD. Again, well, in fact, everything about theology and so on, not everybody agrees with, but it's around about that time. Now, what he's saying is that there are three time frames outlined in this revelation: the past, the present, that is John's present, and the future, past, present, future. The past, write therefore what you have seen. Now, what has John seen that he can write about? Well, he's seen Jesus as he is now, risen and glorified. He's described in chapter 1. Chapter 1 deals with John's past. Jesus as he has been revealed. Then there's the present. What is now? That is to say, John's present, which is actually partly our past and still in our present, we're still in that same period of time. But the present is revealed as the church age. It's covered in chapters 2 and 3. Jesus highlights seven churches, which were real, there and then churches. You could go to them in John's day. But why those particular churches? Well, many Bible scholars believe, and I happen to agree with them, that these seven actual churches were also prophetically represent seven ages, seven eras of the church, stretching from John's present day in AD 95 up to our present day. Now, these letters outline the features of the church in each age, each era of the church, both bad and good. And history can testify to the accuracy of the view that these actual churches are prophetic of the church age, the present, but looking forward to John's future. And then the third part of that, the future, the past, the present, the future. What will take place later? The end times. Now, this starts at chapter 4 and continues until the end of chapter 22. How do we know it starts at the beginning of chapter 4? Well, because of the words that chapter 4, verse 1 starts with, and in fact, that verse ends with as well. In Greek, the two words are meta tauta. Meta tauta means after this, or after these things. Well, what things? Well, after what's just been described, these things. The church age. So after the church age, this is what's going to happen. The church age, in my view, ends with the rapture of the church and launches the period of time known as the tribulation. And chapters 4 and 5 describe the rapture and the church in heaven, with chapter 6 launching into the tribulation with the earth in judgment. Then, in chapter 19, what we see is Jesus returning to earth at the second coming, reigning on earth for 1,000 years in chapter 20, before the new heaven and the new earth appearing in chapters 21 and 22. That's all you need to know. Well, there's a bit more to it than that. But that's the structure. The past, the present, the future. The whole book outlined in chapter 1, verse 19. This next sentence isn't going to make a lot of sense to you unless you've actually heard my teaching on this, but I'll say it anyway. Revelation has in some ways received the same fate as the original Maseroth, the study of the stars, as understood and practiced by the Magi. You see, originally, the heavens declared the glory of God. And each constellation revealed an aspect of the gospel and God's wonderful plan of salvation. However, that was corrupted in Babylon to come to be seen as a secret way of predicting the future of human beings. So astrology has become a modern-day deception and corruption of the original God-ordained thing. Well, a similar fate actually has befallen Revelation. It has become this secret writing that is supposed to reveal the future of human beings, which is not necessarily wrong, but originally the revelation of Jesus Christ was just that. The real story of Revelation is that it helps us to understand who Jesus is. Not to help us to understand about us and our future, that's there, but it's kind of like tangential to the actual main event, which is that it's the revelation of Jesus Christ. It's not the revelation of you lot and where you're going to be headed and how many nuclear warheads it's going to take to get you there. No, it's the revelation of Jesus Christ. It's not fundamentally about us. It's fundamentally about him. It is about our future, but our future as a product of who Jesus is and what he has done. So John's told to start with what he has seen. And so that's exactly where John starts, with Jesus introducing himself. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the first and the last. Or as we've been seeing recently in Hebrew, I am the Aleph and the Tav. This is a direct claim to be God himself. And he was in, as he was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be. Now here in 95 AD, just 60 years after the resurrection, stands Jesus. But he was not just standing randomly. He was standing amongst the seven lampstands. And as John introduces the seven lampstands, he's announced by John as one like a son of man. So as we know, I'm sure, the lampstands represent churches, the light of the world. And Jesus appears amongst the lamps. The Son of Man is a title given to the Messiah in Daniel. And the robe and the sash are the garments of a judge and a king. The hair, as white as wool, is also a picture seen in Daniel. There, God is called the Ancient of Days, with snow-white hair to show that he is, indeed, ancient. My hair's really old, apparently, according to my grandsons. You've got old hair. Well, there you go. At least I've got my own teeth. He has eyes of fire. Fire illuminates, it refines, it purifies. And this is how Jesus views his church. Bronze represents judgment, and Jesus' feet are like bronze glowing in a furnace. His voice is like rushing waters, which means that it is majestic and it's powerful. Out of his mouth comes a double-edged sword. This is a direct reference to the word of God, which comes from the mouth of God and pierces, dividing bone and marrow. Bronze represents judgment. Jesus is pictured as, like I say, having feet that were like bronze glowing in the furnace. His face like the sun, it shines in all its brilliance. Now, we might not be able to picture all of that. All that looks a bit weird when you add it all together as an identikit picture. And you think, goodness me. And we can't really imagine necessarily the sense of awe that John felt at the sight. He's looking at this apparition. But we do know what he did as a direct result. When I saw him, I fell at his feet as though dead. Then he placed his hand on me and said, "Do not be afraid. I am the first and the last. Not only the Aleph and the Tav, but eternal. I am the living one. I was dead, and now look. I am alive forever and ever, and I hold the keys of death and Hades. I am alive forever and ever. Eternal, omnipresent, omniscient, omnipotent. He is God, the same yesterday, today, and forever. He holds the very keys to unlock the gates of Hades. Hades, where according to the Old Testament, all Jews go, the good, the bad, and the ugly, Sheol. And where those who are in the righteous part of Sheol, the righteous part of Hades, will be released to spend eternity with God, with their Lord and their Saviour. He has the keys to unlock Hades. John is instructed to write, therefore, what he has seen. He has seen Jesus, fully God and fully man, standing at the centre of his church. And as we'll see next week, ladies and gentlemen, he is the God who passionately believes in his church and has always been fully committed to his bride. But he is a holy God who will not overlook sin, and who even more fervently than Paul wants his bride to be pure and spotless. And so he challenges the church in each age to aspire to being the church that it can be, that it's destined to be. He will not settle for less, and he will not allow us to just settle for less. He gave his life for you and me, and he calls us to give our lives for him and for his kingdom cause. Now, I feel very passionately about what I really feel that that God's challenging us to at the moment. Kingfisher around the world, and we're going to be looking at this in, I don't know when we're looking at it, when's the vision morning? Pretty soon, that's the one, pretty soon. In a couple of weeks' time, something like that, 3 weeks' time maybe, about being Great Commission disciples, actually being them, actually being filled with the Spirit and taking the Great Commission seriously. Because in every age, including this age, God looks at his church and he says, I believe in you. I believe that you can be more than this. There must be more than this. I believe in you. He calls us to give our lives for him and for his kingdom cause. And this is the revelation of Jesus Christ, the Lord of the church. There is no greater calling, no bigger challenge, and no greater reward than to live our lives for Jesus Christ. We're leaving that there. Next week, we're getting into what is this church age? What is that all about? But for now, let's pray together. And Lord, we're reminded this evening, this is the revelation, not of our future per se, not of how the world is going to pan out. This is the revelation of Jesus Christ, revealed in his glory, revealed in his mission, revealed in his victory. And it's in understanding Jesus that we come to understand ourselves. And so as we gaze upon you this evening, Lord, afresh, we just worship you. John's reaction when he saw you was to fall to the ground as if dead. How can I see God and yet live? Our response so often when seeing you is to wonder what song we're singing next. Lord, forgive us. Lord, raise us up to be the passionate, sold out, Great Commission disciples that we can be. Give us a fresh revelation of Jesus. And may we respond as John responded, in reverence, in awe, in wonder, but absolutely not in apathy. Lord, reveal yourself afresh to us. I pray. Stir our hearts with a passion for you. And I ask it in Jesus' awesome name. Amen.
It starts with the voice that started it all, that gives me a choice to answer the calling on me. Awake, arise, O sleeper, creation groans to hear holy thunder, shaking familiar skies with awesome power, roaring revival over my mind again. May all my opinion make way for kingdom come, kingdom come. It's heaven on earth, the earth really needs given word, a people to be his hands and feet. Awake, arise, O sleeper, creation groans to hear holy thunder, shaking familiar skies with awesome power, roaring revival over my mind again. Where the story ends. What if the journey ahead only depends on my next step? Offered to him in surrender, hear the rolling thunder. What if my ceilings can turn into floors? What if my prison walls turn into open doors? What if I anchor my thoughts in the full weight of his glory, letting my God tell my story? Hear the rolling thunder. With awesome power, roar. roaring revival over my mind again. May your my opinion make way for kingdom come. Kingdom come, we pray. Kingdom come. Kingdom come. I know it's hard when we can't sing together. That was a word that came through somebody else and really caught my spirit. I just want to sing that bridge again, but I really want us to ask ourselves, what if that was actually James's vision for our church back in 2017? It's funny how it's come back round. Would you stand with me, if you're able, for a moment? If you feel comfortable, maybe we could close our eyes. Maybe hold out your hands. The whole point is that this imagery of holy thunder, it's not us. It's not about us striving and making stuff happen in our own strength, our own wisdom. It's God's voice we need to hear. It's His Spirit that we need to fill us and lead us. And we can receive that right now, church. Doesn't matter if you're the other side of a mask, the other side of a camera. His Holy Spirit is here. He's with you. So just take this opportunity. You may not be able to sing along, but you can still receive God's Holy Spirit. You can still hear what He's calling you to. It could be as simple as Him reminding you of His presence with you in this season. But I also want to encourage you that this season, isn't it? Seasons change. Seasons end and a new one will begin. God wants you ready. What if He's calling me out of my depth? What if this season is not where the story ends? What if the journey ahead only depends on my next step? Offered to Him in surrender, hear the rolling thunder. What if my ceilings can turn into floors? Will we believe together? What if my prison walls turn into open doors? Here and now, what if I anchor my thoughts in the full weight of His glory? Letting my God tell my story. Hear the rolling thunder. Shaking familiar skies with awesome power, roaring revival over my mind again. May all my opinion make way for kingdom come. It's kingdom come. Just invite Him. Kingdom come, we pray, Lord.
You know, it's great to know that God's in control. It's great to know that whatever the circumstances, however difficult the present is, however uncertain the future is, God is our rock and He knows what He's doing and we can always, always trust in Him. So I pray that you've been blessed this evening. I pray that as you go into this new week, you go knowing that God is is with you. He's for you. Jesus is the same yesterday, today, and forever. There's no shadow of turning in him. He's got a plan for you. He's got a plan for me. And he knows what he's doing. So, Lord, we just commit to you this coming week. We commit to you all that we know is facing us, all that we don't know is facing us. We thank you so much that we know we can rely fully on you. So thank you for your walk with us in this coming week. In Jesus' name, amen. Have a great week, everyone. And we will be back to normal recording, we hope, for next Sunday. And we're going to be continuing our look at Kingfisher's core values. So, see you then.
To come from you, we exalt you.